Welcome to the NBA's Greatest Games. Today, we'll take you back into NBA history and relive one of the great matchups as it happened.
It was a well-directed Lakers attack that captured the first two games of the NBA Finals. Los Angeles was impressive with their passing and relentless with their running as they overwhelmed a hobbled Celtics team. It was obvious the defending champions were vulnerable, and there were whispers of a sweep. But Boston had other ideas, and they became apparent in Game 3. The unstoppable Laker fast break suddenly ran into roadblocks as the Celtics played with renewed intensity. The heroes included the probable and the great Larry Bird. And the improbable and reserve center Greg Kite, whose tireless labor in the trenches helped spark their victory. Boston's message was clear. And the Lakers took notice. This series is far from over. James Worthy and the Lakers found the bounces a little hard in the Boston Garden, while the hometown bounces found the occasional help for those little green leprechauns. An entire city hopeful tonight that this arena becomes the Garden of Even. And in this neighborhood, the hot color is green, the color of t-shirts. Green as in the color of hats. And yes, also green as in the color of money. It has been green since the arrival of this man, Larry Bird, from Indiana State in 1979. He has kept the Boston Celtics in contention for an NBA championship ever since. And tonight, he will try to do it one more time in Game 4 as CBS Sports welcomes you to its continuing coverage of the 1987 NBA Finals. The Los Angeles Lakers and the Boston Celtics. And after three rounds, the Lakers lead 2-1. Well, good evening, everybody, and welcome. I'm Brent Musburger. You know, in games 1 and 2 out in Los Angeles, the Lakers were so very impressive, winning by 13 and 19. Then in game 3 on Sunday, the Celtics regroup, hard-fought 6-point win. Now the ball is over in Laker coach Pat Riley's corner, you might say. He's the man who must make the adjustments for this game 4. A short time ago, I had the opportunity to ask Pat what adjustments he'd make tonight.
Well, we got to kick it up another level in the effort department. It wasn't as though we didn't make a great effort the other night. It has to be better, Brent, from a defensive standpoint, reacting, alert, communicating, position, all of those things that are little things across the board defensively that I don't think we got done. We were one step behind most of the night, and we paid a price for it. So defensively, I think our effort's going to be a lot better and a lot more concentrated.
Yes, indeed. For the last 48 hours, the Los Angeles Lakers have locked themselves up. They have practiced hard. I would be shocked if they didn't come out and play with a great deal of intensity tonight in the first 5 minutes. Now let's get out of the floor. The gentleman will call the action for you, Dick Stockton and Tommy Heinsohn. Dick.
All right, Brent, I agree with you. I think they will, and it was Pat Riley who said, no rebounds, no rings. I think that's where the concentration will be tonight because the Celtics got a lot of second shots on offensive rebounds, and that can break the back of a club, and the Celtics work hard to get them. So now the Lakers want to be more aggressive, and we could see a war inside for the battle around the rims in there. And Tommy Heinsohn, people say that if the Lakers have any kind of vulnerability at all, it may be on the boards. What do you think?
Well, they have a 40-year-old center, Dick, and Robert Parrish will battle with Kareem. And I think Kevin McHale and A.C. Green is a matchup. They both, the Lakers, must block out the two Celtics. What has helped the Lakers in the past is Magic Johnson. They've been gang rebounding against the Celtics, and that's how they've been effectively stopping them on the board. That is, until game 3.
Tommy, we heard from Pat Riley about his adjustments. Now, Casey Jones made an adjustment that resulted in a victory, and the Celtics have to continue that same road tonight.
Well, he preached like the monk, patience and position, and they got the old-time religion. And one of the things that they have to do is catch him, and they did it well. Biggest change by Casey Jones was in his substitution pattern. In the first two games in L.A., the Boston defense was constantly outnumbered, usually 3-2. And the Lakers destroyed them with a fast break. The insertion of Greg Kite at the Game 3 gave Boston a healthier set of legs that could get back and slow down the Laker breaks. Now they had three defenders, not just two. The Celtic defense also picked up James Worthy further outside, not allowing him to go airborne to the basket. And the smart shot selection by Dennis Johnson, whom the Lakers dared to take the shot, put Boston back in the series.
Tommy, Dennis Johnson still is a key for the Celtics tonight, but what man would you point to on the Lakers?
I'd say A.C. Green, Dick. They need A.C. Green for his quick feet to really utilize the speed more effectively on the fast break. He didn't play a lot in Game 3 because he didn't defend Kevin McHale that much. They need him in a lineup tonight to really go.
All right, Tommy. Well, Brent, this is a schizophrenic Celtic club. They have lost their last six on the road, but they are won their last six right here in Boston Garden. The starting lineups tonight for game number four for the visiting Los Angeles Lakers. It'll be James Worthy and A.C. Green at forward. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar the center, and Magic Johnson and Byron Scott in the backcourt. And Pat Riley, Larry Bird, Kevin McHale, Robert Parrish, Danny Ainge, and Dennis Johnson, Casey Jones. The officials tonight, Hugh Evans, Earl Strom, who's working in the finals for the 25th year, and Jake O'Donnell is the alternate. This is the way the series has gone. The Lakers won two blowouts in L.A. and the Celtics won the game Sunday here in Boston, and it's Lakers ball.
I think the Lakers must continue to run, but they must focus on the tail end of their fast break, the fourth and fifth man up. I think those are the guys that are going to be open today.
Kareem misses, and there's A.C. Green, who keeps the ball alive, the man that Tommy talked about, who has to come alive in this one. They got Parrish in foul trouble in game number three. And the foul. McHale helping Parrish. And Kareem will shoot a pair.
Celtics are playing Kareem one up until he puts the ball on the floor and rolls to the middle. Then they attempt a double.
That was the matchup, and of course a big one for Kareem. But Greg Kite came in and had 9 rebounds off the bench and was an unlikely hero for Boston. There is Kite, who is expected to play the same amount, if not more, tonight.
I think Kareem may need to play more minutes tonight, and really, as this series unfolds, he may become more of a factor than Pat Riley would maybe like him to be.
He struggled from the line in the last game and doesn't start off well here. Worthy on Bird. Picked up by Green on a switch. Dennis Johnson. And Green the rebound. Already we've seen A.C. Green more active at both ends. Bird intercepts the pass. It's a 3-on-2 for Boston. McHale. McHale again. Still no score. With over a minute gone by. Scott. Air ball. Good defense by Dennis Johnson.
They have really gotten out in the prior game and stopped Scott's long shot on that fast break.
Scott shoots much better in the forum than he does at Boston Garden. McHale, doubled. And he's had a lot of chances. And here come the Lakers with a 4-on-3 break. Magic. Still no score, but there's A.C. Green. Scott. And there are the second chance points. But A.C. Green certainly in the play.
He has got the speed, particularly when McHale and Parrish are in there, to outdistance either one of them. And he can really help them on clean up rebounds.
Took nearly 2 minutes for the first basket to be scored. Bird off the screen. And here comes Magic. Worthy against Bird. He pumped a couple of times, and Worthy, who struggled, had as quiet as playoff game. Larry Bird, a lot of misses so far, and Scott comes out of it. The Celtics are 0 for 6 from the field, and A.C. Green comes in and is fouled. There was a Laker break, but let's watch Bird on Worthy defensing one-on-one.
It's key for Bird to make good decisions to get back quickly, not go for the rebound. And immediately he's right there with Worthy. He picked one off earlier in the quarter, and right now he's right there, angled him off, made him take a tough shot.
So far, the Lakers have missed all three of their free throws. The personal foul was on Dennis Johnson. A.C. Green. It's a big reason why the Lakers made their comeback here, but has been silent in postseason here in this series.
I don't think they've used him or had to use him in the prior games, the fourth man up. He could get a lot of layups for the Lakers on their break.
Speaking of layups, Dennis Johnson is fouled going to the basket. What a game Dennis Johnson had. He came through with his best game with 26 Sunday.
I think it's going to be axiomatic that every time Dennis Johnson drives, he's got to make the basket. Because if he goes to the hoop and doesn't make the basket, he leaves the backcourt barren of defenders when the Lakers get possession.
Dennis Johnson with a big edge over Byron Scott in that matchup in game three. The personal foul was on A.C. Green. And you talked about Dennis Johnson penetrating, and it really backfired against the Celtics in the second game of the series.
He missed the shots, and they gobbled them up in their defense, stole the ball from them, and off they went.
Kareem misses the hook. Nearly 3 minutes gone by, and it's a 3-2 ball game, Los Angeles. Green is on Parrish. And the Chief has an edge there.
That's a matchup I think the Celtics are going to key on. Take it to Green.
Scott missed, and A.C. Green on the follow-up.
He's roaming around uncontested out there, A.C. Green.
Coming off his playoff low of 2 points. They double McHale out of bounds. Magic and Kareem.
A.C. Green uses his speed effectively. Nobody really puts a body on him. They're looking for the penetration, and he uses that speed to create room for the offensive rebound and hoop.
Dennis Johnson goes in and makes the layup. And the Celtics lead. Worthy has his shot blocked. Bird underneath. Here's a 3-on-2 Celtics, and Danny Ainge throws the ball away.
Is a good fast break opportunity for Boston. Dennis Johnson just holding up his hand. Slow down, Danny. Let's not get out of control. Let's have that patience that Casey wants.
Kareem misses another sky hook. 4 minutes gone by, first period. Ainge goes for three. Kareem in the hands of Magic, and it's a 4-on-3 break for the Lakers. Scott hit that shot in Los Angeles in the first two games.
Casey Jones is very unhappy with the five Celtics starters right now. Wants them to slow down.
The Celtics have hit only 2 of 9. The Lakers are worse. They're 2 of 12. Another three-point shot attempt by Danny Ainge, who's 6 of 12 for the series. Magic answers that with a two-point attempt, and it's 9-7 Boston.
The Lakers are not getting layups on the hard push up the court. They're settling for outside shots, too.
And we have a Laker foul against A.C. Green. That'll be his second personal foul on the second-year player from Oregon State.
He has trouble really moving people out of that sweet spot in the low post, particularly a bigger player.
Kevin McHale with a fall-away. Offensive rebounds. The Celtics have dominated the last two games, but the Lakers have the edge early. Kareem Good defense by Parrish. Magic is there, and now another offensive rebound by the Lakers brings LA to within a couple.
Magic Johnson is the X factor. His rebounding can give them a real plus, the Lakers.
Worthy on the foul on Bird. And a timeout. 6:38 to go in the first. Well, the fans wear all kinds of hats, and with one of the fans right now, or two for that matter, is James Brown. JB?
All right, Dick, thank you very much. You may recall last week my colleague Pat O'Brien talked with some people at the LA Forum who said they paid $40,000, that's $10,000 per courtside ticket. Now, that compares with $1,500 per courtside ticket here in Boston. And these two guys, Ron and Mel, indicate that there's more than just an obvious cost difference between those seats. What's the benefit?
Memories. Memories and the greatest fans in the world. They're just unbelievable. I was here when they won their first championship, and there's nothing like it. Just look at the banners.
But you don't get a chance to sit next to movie stars and celebrities.
Sweet life. This is Celtics family, like Red Auerbach said. It's a one big, happy family. And there's nothing like the Celtics. It's the mystique here. Look at the first period, what's happening right now.
I'd be interested to hear an L.A. response, but let's get back to Dick.
All right, JB, and I guess that's why these teams, L.A. and Boston, don't put up conference championship banners, just world titles. Anyway, Kurt Rambis is coming the ball game for the Lakers. And Rambis takes the shot, and Bird gets the rebound.
Now, this makes the Lakers a lot faster than when Kareem is in there, and Thompson at the center spot. They may be looking for him, the Lakers.
Dennis Johnson down the middle, and he's been effective, penetrating, basket counts, and a foul.
Dennis Johnson saved his drives to the basket to the end of the game. Tonight, they're seeing him right early going to the hoop, and the defense is so totally concerned with the big players that they forgot about the penetration of Dennis.
Three-point play. The foul was on Michael Thompson. We're at Boston Garden for game four of the 1987 NBA Finals. Lakers lead 2-1, and the Celtics trying to even the series at 2 apiece. Magic Johnson misses. McHale, and we're winding down to 2 minutes to go in the first, and Cooper right up on Dennis Johnson.
Boston is really blocking out on that defensive board.
Magic on a steal as Ainge try to get it inside. There's a 2-on-3 now for the Lakers, and Magic. And they're going to call the foul the other way against Magic Johnson. Offensive foul.
It was just a turnover, Dick.
Just a turnover. Okay. Just knocked it away. No foul called. Kite setting a screen up top. 1:40 to play. Biggest lead of the game, 7 for Boston now. And McHale.
Michael Thompson has the leg strength to knock McHale off the box. Look how far he's got him worked up the lane already. McHale trying to back down to that red box at the bottom of your screen. And now it's an easier double. The further up the lane you can make McHale work, the easier it is for him to double, the more difficult shot he must take.
The Celtics, who shot 81% in the second period on Sunday, after that woeful 32, shooting very well in the first period. Jerry Seasting has come in to replace Dennis Johnson for the Celtics. So it'll be Ainge and Seasting in the backcourt. And McHale makes 1. But the biggest lead now, 8 points for the Celtics. And of course, with Kareem on the bench, Michael Thompson is the center on the floor, with Rambis and Worthy up front. Magic gets free inside. Don't think he had control of that shot. Fighting right in the middle of that group. And the basket's going to count, and a foul. Kite saying, what happened? Well, the Lakers scored, and there's a personal to boot, and the foul is on Kite.
But the Lakers really banged hard on this play. There's a lot of Celtic white jerseys around. They all hang tough. There's 4 purple jerseys against 3 white jerseys, and then they finally come up with the basket. Michael Thompson really hustling hard.
Tommy, I think it's a sign of things to come, the way they're battling inside. The rebounding is where the Lakers thought they fell short Sunday.
This first quarter has been all Boston's tempo. And it's because I believe A.C. Green is out of there, and the Lakers are forced to go to their half-court offense more and more with Michael Thompson.
Ainge goes for three. He's hit one already this period. And Magic can't save it. McHale. And it counts.
There's Magic size coming to the advantage, but a heads-up play by Seasting, and Kite right there makes a good pass to McHale, who thought somebody was on him, and then took it to the hoop. Cooper caught up, but banged him from behind.
And a good time to take out Larry Bird, who has scored only 2 points, but he'll get a breather with 49 seconds left in the period. And then the pause between the first and second as Darren Day comes in, and you're so right, the Lakers scored 30 or more points in 7 of the 8 quarters in L.A. They didn't score 30 in any quarter on Sunday, and right now they have 19. And no basket. Foul before the shot, and it'll be a shooting situation. Definitely a Boston-paced first period. And Robert Parrish comes in, and Kevin McHale goes out, having scored 7 points. He also had 6 boards.
And if you're going to compare these two teams, it's like Muhammad Ali and Joe Frazier, we said. And Joe Frazier right now has taken Muhammad Ali off his toes and has started to back Muhammad into the corner. And Riley can sense it. Casey Jones saying, this is just the way we want this game to go.
Lakers having trouble from the line in the first period, trailing by 7. Eight on the shot clock. Ainge makes good on a runner, and the Celtics starting backcourt has 18 of their 29 points. Magic Johnson gets the basket despite contact. The final seconds of period. But Boston has the lead, and that's the end of the first period. Celtics 29, Lakers 22. We'll return to Raucous Boston Garden after this word from your local station. The Celtics lead the Lakers 29-22. It was reversed in game 3 as you look at the USS Constitution in Charlestown, Massachusetts. As we welcome you to CBS Sports' exclusive coverage of the 1987 NBA Finals, the story so far, an unusual Celtic backcourt scoring edge. The Lakers have missed 5 free throws, and Danny Ainge, who had been struggling, has a hot first period. So in game 3, it was the Lakers 29-22 here the other way around as we start the second. It's Dennis Johnson with Seasting, Bird, Parrish, and McHale up front. Bird with a pass to Parrish. Laker ball out of the break. Cooper. He has Scott Worthy, Michael Thompson. It's a 4-man break for L.A. And Kareem, who's starting this period, misses. Out of bounds, Lakers possession.
I tell you how hard Kareem wants to win this thing. He ended up as a wingman on the fast break. That's real desire.
And James Worthy, who will inbound the pass, has yet to score. There's the 40-year-old Kareem. And Worthy, who's been the high scorer in the playoffs for the Lakers, has 0. Thought Scott traveled, but they're not reffing this game. Parrish the rebound on the missed sky hook. It's a 3-on-2 break. Worthy comes back defensively. Dennis Johnson open. Hit 7 in a row during a stretch of Sunday's game, and now the Lakers with a 4-on-3. Cooper misses, and the Lakers struggling from the field.
and making the Lakers take bad shots. The Celtics with this go out and get them defense.
Seasting throws it away, and now it's 3-on-3 for L.A. Cooper with a move around Bird. Bird blocks the shot. Great play by Bird. 3-on-2 now, Boston. McHale. A 9-point lead. That's what it was after the period.
Nothing can demoralize a fast break team more than when the other team fast breaks you.
All this despite the fact that the Lakers have a huge 9-1 edge in offensive rebounds on Boston. But the Lakers are shooting 28% for the game. It's a good thing they're getting some second shots. They may be blown out now.
This has been an unusual game for who is going to produce the points.
Kareem hits the hook. He has 6.
Old reliable. Helps get you back in the game. Peck away. If you don't have the break, get it to Kareem. That's their style from 2 years ago.
Larry Bird still doesn't have a basket. Guarded by Cooper. Shuffle pass goes all the way through, and it's Lakers ball. So the Celtics don't even get a shot on. They missed their first 6 in the opening period. They're 0-for-5 right now. But they're leading by 7.
Larry Bird does excellent job on defense. He fakes back in here and forces Cooper to bring the ball back to him. He's underneath the basket, so Cooper has to bring the ball to him. You watch, underneath, and right there as he brings it back to him, gets a piece of it, holds on to it. Now the next part of this is outstanding. The Celtics, a very slow team, end up with a 3-on-2 situation. 1-2 defenders. Dennis Johnson will take it here, make these two men commit, and then pass the ball to McHale, who comes for the layup. And that's exceptional basketball for a slow team. Beautiful play by Dennis Johnson and Larry Bird to trigger that break.
31% shooting so far for the Lakers, who went into the game shooting 56% for the series, although both teams were under 50 in game number 3. So just under 10 minutes remaining in the first half. It's 31-24. The Lakers well below what they normally score for this juncture. Worthy posting up against McHale. And Parrish blocks it away. Good double team by Parrish. 6-0. And saves it into the hands of Kareem. But the Lakers aren't getting the breaks. Actually, the Celtics seem to be running more right now. Another perimeter shot by Michael Thompson.
They ran with their twin towers in there. Bird on a previous possession tried to get Seasting's head into the game by getting him the ball, let him take an outside shot, get his head together.
Magic Johnson will be checking back in. Blocking foul on James Worthy will be his 2nd foul.
The Celtics are playing the Lakers, and James Worthy in particular, much like the Rockets did last year. They drive him to help, and there's Robert Parrish, the 2nd defender, ever so alert to block the ball away.
Magic is back in, and James Worthy sits down for the Lakers. Worthy has not scored tonight. In fact, has only 4 points in the last 4 quarters of play. He was silent after the opening period of game number 3.
I think psychologically, if he doesn't get a few fast break buckets, it disturbs his confidence.
And the Lakers with a chance to cut the Celtic lead to 3. Eight and a half to go in the 2nd period. Magic. With that shot put shot now has 11 points. He leads the Lakers. Ainge with 11 leads the Celtics.
Now Magic Johnson is the man that must run the show out here. Get the people the right shot and himself the right shot.
McHale, the ball jarred away. Given up his dribble. Dennis Johnson with 4 seconds on the shot clock. Has to take a wild shot, but there's McHale with a big offensive rebound, just as he did in the closing minutes of Sunday's game. Magic with a sky hook from where Kareem normally tries it, and it's a three-point affair again.
With Magic in the low post to diversify the low post attack with Kareem, it really puts a challenge to the Celtics defense.
Speaking of challenges, Tommy, A.C. Green's going to come in, and if he can hold his own off the boards, we may see that running game by L.A. again. Robert Parrish. And again, it's a five-point game. Scott has plenty of time for a three. Nothing doing. Out of bounds, and it's Lakers ball. Larry Bird has had only three shots from the field. His 2 points have come from the line. He was 2 of 12 after the first period in Sunday's game, but he came back and scored 30, so he can explode before it's over.
Well, Bird can get hot, but right now he's secure to do things like this, grab rebounds and help get some easy hoop.
2-on-1, Parrish driving in. Sprained ankle at all, he looks pretty good there.
McHale came alive the last ball game, and Parrish is running freer now.
I think the Celtics look like they're getting healthier as the series goes on. Bird. Defensive rebounding as he did in game three. Parrish misses, and here's Scott, 4-on-1. Kareem is back there and used as a pick as Cooper gets the layup. Good way to use Kareem.
And Kareem went right up behind Dennis Johnson, so he couldn't move at all. That was absolutely a fantastic play by Kareem.
That's when you have a 4-on-1 and you'll say, we only need three. Why don't you set a pick?
Those types of fast breaks are coach destroyers. Coaches usually call timeout and say, you guys got to get back, and an argument start in the huddle.
Foul is on Scott.
Here's Bird coming right in. This is where he can help them the most, control the defensive board for the Celtics, and he's doing his job.
He has 7 rebounds, Larry Bird. Right now, let's go over to James Brown. JB?
All right, Dick, thank you very much. One of the most overworked topics of this series is trying to understand what benefit the Celtics get from playing in the Garden where they've lost so few times. Now, many people point to the parquet floor, which was installed over 40 years ago. There are a number of uneven ridges and dead spots on the floor. Standing with me now is Paul Dembicki, who's a carpenter foreman. As you take a look at that floor, is the construction of this floor such that it's less than desirable to play on?
Well, without the ice down, the concrete leaves a lot of areas that are unlevel, and consequently, there are more ridges and dead spots.
And you said that the Celtics get a psychological advantage.
Absolutely. We've Local 33 has offered to reconstruct the floor completely. The Celtics want it left like it is because psychologically, they feel they can win.
And the Celtics were going to save $100,000 with the new floor, but they didn't want to change it. Let's go back to you, Dick.
Thank you very much, JB. And, of course, JB's filling in for Pat O'Brien, who today is the proud father of a 6-pound, 13-ounce baby boy, Sean Patrick O'Brien. And the youngster and Linda O'Brien are doing fine, and a future sportscaster perhaps will host at the half one of these years. Huh?
Well, I thought he was going to have a mustache.
Congratulations to Pat and Linda. James Worthy is back in the ball game, so it's Worthy, Green, and Michael Thompson up front, and Kareem sits down for the second time. Under 6 minutes to go, first half, 5-point Celtic lead. Ainge shooting over Green, tough shot with Green in his face. Another offensive rebound for the Celtics. Dennis Johnson, Magic. Into the hands of Worthy, and this is a 3-on-1 L.A. break. Cooper, what happened? Did Michael Thompson not fill it quick enough, or was it the pass?
It was the pass, and it was thrown a little low, but Dennis Johnson with that drive left the backcourt uncovered, so they had a 3-on-1, a perfect opportunity to score the Lakers.
They have attempted 13 more shots from the field, but they haven't converted them because they're only 34%. So you can get the shots, but if you don't make them, you're where the Lakers are, trailing by 5. Well, as you know, this is the 10th time that, and even if you didn't know, that these teams have bet for the NBA title, and here's a look back. Celtics have won every year these teams have played for the title except one. And that was in 85 when the Lakers won in six games. In fact, won the deciding game here at Boston Garden. And right now the Lakers lead 2-1 but have trailed since the early going. So the Celtics with an effort to try to come back and even this series. Game number five will be Thursday night here at Boston Garden.
You know, Dick, this floor, I think players come in and they psych themselves. That's why the Celtics don't want to change it. I don't think it's any different. A.C. Green was out here bouncing balls, and I looked at him and I said, you know, A.C., the ball has got 9 pounds of air pressure in it. It's going to come back up to you.
It'd be funny if it didn't once. Mikhail winds his way in and draws the foul. 13 foul against the Lakers. Hey, Kevin looks spryer, and so does Parrish. And I know they've been banged up and hurt, but they're not looking that way.
I think that flu that Kevin McHale had out in Detroit when he played with the three soda crackers in the 7-Up was really what drained him. And I don't think he got healthy until Sunday, where he felt physically able to play regardless of the foot.
The boards. You know, after the first two games, Byron Scott of the Lakers had more rebounds than McHale. Then McHale picked off 10 in game three. He's got a bunch tonight.
He gets my red badge of courage to go through what he went through in that Detroit series.
5 minutes to go in the half. The lead is 7. Magic doesn't get the bounce, but will go to the line. First team foul against the Celtics. They have stayed out of that foul situation for most of this second period.
You know, when Magic Johnson gets his hands on the ball and they try to play some kind of team defense, Danny Ainge is having trouble staying with a one-on-one. That time, Danny Ainge sent him to the baseline expecting help, but it arrived too late in the form of Robert Parrish, and that's what caused the foul.
The lead has fluctuated from 5 to 9. The Lakers got it down to 3 a couple of times. Their last lead was 5-4 in the first couple of minutes. Parrish put a move on A.C. Green and left him flat-footed.
A.C. Green cannot guard Robert Parrish, and he's having trouble with McHale, just not allowing him the good sweet spot in the low post.
Another lefty hook by Magic Johnson, who has 17 points in the game.
He's doing it every which way. Outside, on layups, drive, left and right hooks in the low post. That's diversity.
Coming off his playoff high of 32 Sunday. 5-point lead. Celtics keeping the Lakers at bay. Parrish again. Parrish has done a number on A.C. Green.
And just attacking A.C. Green. Whoever he's guarding, he's going to face the ball.
Magic gets his own rebound and converts. So 19 for Magic in the first half, and we still have nearly 4 minutes remaining.
What a player Magic is. Oh.
That's what I would say. Dennis Johnson leaving Ainge for 3. DJ gets the offensive rebound. What a hard-earned basket that was for Johnson.
Well, he goes and gets them every which way, too.
There it is again.
Another heads-up play by Magic. Read the defense, saw that one of the Celtics was going to make a mistake, and there was A.C. Green all alone.
It's 45-40. The Lakers are lurking. Determined, I think, to break Cooper's three-point shooting mark in this first half. Traveling against Magic Johnson. Tommy, the Lakers have had several fast break chances, and they've come up with nothing.
They've been just trying to make it happen too hard, not taking what's there. On the offensive glass. You see him lean to the left, and Danny Ainge does not block him off, and he alertly steps right inside. Nice block out of Bird by A.C. Green to create the opening for Magic for the layup. AC Green left on your screen using his speed. McHale loses him and Worthy finds him right underneath. Now the Celtics hustled back but never did find AC Green.
But the story of this first half from the Lakers standpoint is that James Worthy has yet to score and has taken only four shots. Right now, let's go to James Brown. Robert Parrish went to the dressing room, JB. What was it about?
All right, Dick, it appeared to look a little serious, but all Robert Parrish did was slip on the floor on that one ankle that's beginning to give him an awful lot of problems. He went into the locker room just to get a retape, the precautionary measure. He'll be back.
Thanks, JB. And Greg Kite is in there, so up front it's Kite, McHale, and Bird. Bird, by the way, still looking for his first basket of the game. Who would have figured that Bird and Worthy wouldn't get a hoop this far in? Dennis Johnson with 11 points, most of them on penetration.
What a play by Dennis Johnson. He made the Laker defense rotate with a fake pass.
Worthy still comes up shy. With less than 2.5 to play, Boston by 7. And Bird and Worthy might as well be home watching this on TV. Either way.
You would never believe that these clubs could be like this without the Worthy and Bird producing offensively.
You're right, they do other things, though, and we've got to be fair that way. Danny Ainge, that's for 2, and he's got 13. 2 minutes to go in the first half. The Celtics, again, with a 9-point lead. That's been their biggest. Boy, the Lakers with only 40 points to this point. Definitely a Celtic pace game. Worthy gets on the board and has a chance for 3. And that's his first basket after 5 misses.
What the Celtics are doing are forcing him to step out a little bit further. Now he's in a little bit closer. It's a one dribble, strong move to the hoop. McHale, even with his leaping ability and long arms, can't get at Worthy's shot because Worthy is a great jumper.
McHale the foul, his 2nd. Under 2 minutes to go. The Celtics have led virtually all the way in game number 4 of the 1987 NBA Finals. Dick Stockton and Tom Heinsohn at Boston Garden. Lakers leading in the series 2-1. And Danny Ainge hits another 2-point shot. He has 15 first half points. And the Boston lead is 8. Lakers have been trying to play catch up against the Celtic team. Far cry from the first 2 games in Los Angeles. Worthy may be getting hot now, and he has 5 quick ones.
He's getting the feel. That time he was a little bit further out, but that little spin move freed him from McHale. McHale played him to the middle that time, and Worthy picked it up, went the other way.
Under a minute now. And McHale fights his way in against Kareem. He leads with 15, tied with Ainge, and a steal. Loose ball, and it's Kareem protecting it. 20 on the shot clock. Loose ball, and it's Johnson. 3-on-2 break for Boston. Ainge. And Rambis, and it's a 5-on-2 for the Lakers. And Worthy is decked, and Worthy doesn't like it. And Greg Kite was tagged. Both coaches have come on to try to cool things down. And Tommy, that was a very rough takedown of James Worthy.
Yes, it was. I believe it was Greg Kite who would be physical on a play, but one of the things that people feel about James Worthy is that if you hit him hard on the layups, he stops going strong to the basket. It's an intimidation thing. But here you're going to see Kite just come at him and really take him down. That was a hard foul. Now Worthy was going to get it. He should have not come up and started swinging. Yeah. And Kite comes back at him. What's going to happen now is in the lap of the guards as far as Worthy and Kite are concerned.
How would you compare that to the Laimbeer Bird incident in Detroit?
Different situation, I think. Each play is different. Now, do they throw anybody out of this game? It's an uneven swap if they throw Worthy and Kite out.
No way they'll throw Worthy out.
Well,
there's no way they can throw him out.
All Kite should get on that is really the foul.
Right.
And that's it.
It depends upon whether they determine when there was a fighting foul. Both players threw punches.
On Dennis Johnson. Here is Earl Strom. And a double technical foul has been called on both James Worthy and Greg Kite. Both coaches got in there in a hurry, Tommy. Riley right in the middle of it.
Now these teams not only are going to play seven games, but they have had a history of going at each other in the series, and there's a lot of things from the past that resurrect themselves in people's memories when the emotions start to boil over.
Worthy shooting the two free throws on the foul on the play. And when the teams talk about being more aggressive and inside play being key, not surprising that something like this might erupt.
NBA put in a rule to try and eliminate those hard fouls.
The lead is six for the Celtics, and they can play out the first half. We got fireworks in this one. McHale with 1 second to go. And that one was right on target and bounced out, and the crowd likes what they see. That's the end of the first half. The score, Boston 55, LA 47. Brent Musburger and Julius Erving will be back with the Prudential at the half after this message. Halftime in Boston Garden, and the Old North Church lit up from behind. It's 55 to 47 in favor of the Boston Celtics. And it may be like an old-time Boston-LA rivalry. A lot of people think something was missing. Well, watch this. Dennis Johnson fouled James Worthy, and Johnson and Kite, it looked like, both put down Worthy. And Worthy, who had not had a productive first period, then started going after Kite. A double technical foul was called on Worthy and Kite. No shots taken. And a personal foul was charged to Dennis Johnson. Look at Pat Riley getting right in the middle, and what else is new? This is another angle of the same play, and this is Worthy going in. Dennis Johnson commits the foul, and Kite, both of them with a hard takedown, which has been part of a lot of what we've seen in the playoffs. So no one was thrown out of the game, and the officials seem to handle it very well. Tommy, your observations at halftime here with the Celtics in command at this point.
One of the things that should be considered is that all the Celtics starters played over 20 minutes, and the Lakers count on building up a fatigue factor, and it very well could work to the advantage of the Lakers now coming in the second half. Casey Jones did not use his bench as well as he in this game as well as he did in game three.
And right now, we're going to go over to James Brown for a report. JB?
All right, Dick, thank you very much. I talked with the Laker coaching staff about the first half, and they indicated that they are pretty much resigned to the fact that the Celtics have and probably will continue to stop their fast break. So they've got to exercise more patience on the offensive end, better shot selection. And, of course, that plays into the Celtics' hands. Additionally, the worst omen that the Laker coaching staff saw was that Larry Bird was 0 for 3 and only 2 points, and they're still down by 8. Back to you, Dick.
Thank you, JB, and that's scary if you're looking at it from the Laker point of view. Dennis Johnson hits the first shot, and now the Celtics have their biggest lead of the game, 10 points. Tommy was talking about McHale, 23 minutes, Bird, 23. Dennis Johnson, 22 minutes, and Ainge, 21.
Particularly the big guys. McHale, more so than anybody else, I think. Those minutes could hurt him.
Worthy hits. Tommy, what do you think of the Laker reaction that they don't think that they're going to be able to run against this team now?
Well, they've got other options. The fourth, fifth man up the court, that's part of the break that ought to be able to work. Plus that quick hitter attack. Get the ball to Worthy before the total Celtic defense is set up.
Worthy got a lot of points just before halftime, and Scott missing outside. Kareem to Scott. And Scott hits. So Byron Scott, only his second basket of the ball game, and he is under 40% in games here at Boston Garden.
Well, he's been the one as dramatically affected in his shooting rhythm as Worthy has been in his trip.
And Larry Bird gets his first basket of the game with a minute and a half gone by in the third period. He has four. Scott drives the baseline and is hooked by Dennis Johnson. Here is the way the Lakers scoring went in the first half with Magic. Remember the balanced scoring they had in the first two games? Not so, so far in this ball game. And the Celtics have the balanced scoring. Bird at the bottom of the list. Won't be there for long. 10-point game. Worthy gets it to Kareem. And beating Green of the ball is McHale. His outlet to Bird. Fakes a pass and is fouled by Scott in the act of shooting.
The Celtics don't fast break often because they don't have the good foot speed. But you've got to be alert. You watch Kevin McHale. Now, the Celtic defense way in the paint, and Kareem is forced to take a fall away. McHale right over the top of Green. And McHale, good up, head up, looking for the outlet.
Scott has three personal fouls. The only other player with three fouls in the game is Dennis Johnson. And the Celtics raise the lead to 12.
What's going on in this game was one of the reasons Pat Riley a couple of years ago went to Mitch Kupchak and Maurice Lucas to get some wide bodies to battle the Celtics.
Worthy gets the offensive rebound and the baseline shot. Worthy did not score in the first period, has 11 now. But the LA fast break has disappeared.
Getting him in good ways now, too. That was an exceptional basket by Worthy. A rebound.
Parrish from the left of the key. Celtics have not missed here in the third. And Worthy defensed by McHale, who got a piece of the ball. Kareem swoops him to get the rebound and a three-on-two break for L.A. Scott slices in.
That's what the Lakers have to do to get back in it. Keep putting the physical pressure on these players that played a lot of some 20 minutes in that first half.
Both teams under 50% shooting for the half. Boston at 49, the Lakers at 39. And Bird has his shot snuffed by Worthy and a foul against Kevin McHale. And for McHale, that will be his third. And a timeout. And it with 8:37 to go. The Celtics by 10.
Screen, you're going to see the 24-second clock. The Lakers have played great defense for 19 seconds. They have no place to go, the Celtics. It goes way out to Bird. Hard rush by A.C. Green. But Bird still has patience, and nobody gets to him, and he launches a three-pointer as the clock goes off, and those are the type of shots that really, really hit the heart.
Larry Bird had 2 points in the first half, no baskets, and 9 so far in the third period. All 5 Celtics starters are in double figures, and all of their points have come from their starting 5. And in the game for the Lakers, Michael Cooper and Michael Thompson. Kareem stays in, along with Magic and Worthy. Thompson.
That is not a bad matchup to go to. Bird is not a good low post defender. If he's going to guard Michael Thompson, they can get some good points down there.
And you see the fast break production dwindling from the first two games. Just under 7 minutes to go in the third. McHale over Kareem. Magic is low post against Ainge and scores, and you wonder why the Lakers might not go to that more.
Well, Danny Ainge could not handle them, but they are running at Magic as soon as he puts it on the floor and takes it to the middle. And he's reading it beautifully.
He's made just about all the right decisions, hasn't he?
The Celtics have really made that inside game pay against the Lakers, and the tempo is theirs.
Three on the shot clock. And a technical foul called against Michael Cooper, who's joined with Kevin McHale. For what, Pat Riley is yelling at Earl Strom. Bird will try it. He's cool so far.
He's a courageous coach. I think he really reached true greatness this season. He put himself out on a limb. Could have lost his job if this fast break style didn't work.
Illegal defense called against the Celtics. That is the first of the game.
At the end of the basket is Michael Cooper, and he just pops McHale underneath. And McHale a little bit upset, and Earl Strom right on that call.
That was the first illegal defense called in this game. Five of them were called against the Lakers in game three. And Magic nearly gets a chance for a three. He was pushed, and Robert Parrish picks up his third personal foul, and Magic Johnson, who was the leading scorer in the ball game, tied with McHale with 21, goes to the line for two.
Boston in this quarter is really tempoing the game exactly the way they want it and have done when they've had great success all season.
And you saw Robert Parrish. He's hit four in a row. Kevin McHale has hit his last five, and the Celtics can't seem to miss from the field. 14-point lead, Celtics. Missed just one shot this period. Bird. Look at Bird fight for the rebound, and it's tipped up and in. And the basket will count. A goaltending call against the Lakers.
The offensive rebound's paying off once again for Boston. Kareem got frustrated, went up, and tipped it out of the basket from underneath.
And now they're taking the basket away.
Claiming that McHale did it, and it really wasn't. It was Kareem.
We may have a chance to see.
Let's take a look. Here's Bird, puts it up. And there's Kareem.
It was Kareem.
Kareem touched it.
Oh! McHale the rebound. So the Celtics don't get the hoop. But they get the ball back here with 5:15 to go in the third. And Parrish is five straight. 16-point lead.
He's got the rainbow going, and there's no rain.
And Magic slams two through. And Ainge gets two back. Again, but Tommy, the Lakers have not gone inside at all offensively lately.
No, they haven't. Magic is kind of trying to take this game over and get them back in. No fast break opportunities. It's one-on-one Magic right now against all the Celtics.
Larry Bird misses the rebound by Michael Thompson. This is a two-on-three break. The trailer is Magic, and it'll be Celtics ball.
It ended up a 3-on-4 fast break. That is not the numbers game that Pat Riley wants to see. He wants to see it the other way, a 4-on-3.
Well, he brings in A.C. Green, who's been a big part this year in the Laker fast break, who hasn't gotten it done in this playoff. He is into the ball game. Kareem goes out.
They are bringing this lineup in there now. This is their fastest lineup with Michael Thompson and Green in there. And now Pat Riley's hoping that that fatigue factor will work in his favor right now with the speedier team.
And Scott replaces Magic. So they're even quicker now.
Cooper does not handle that fast break quite as well as Magic does.
Worthy against McHale, one-on-one with seven on the shot clock. Great move by James Worthy.
And he eluded two Celtics that time.
Magic with 27 getting a breather. The Celtics are shooting 71% here in the third period. They shot 81 in the second period in game three.
But the Lakers are so capable of exploding themselves for quick baskets.
The lead is 12. No comfort zone yet for the Celtics. Harris misses. And a new clock for Boston. Lakers can put on a spurt like no other team in the league. Bird has 12 points in the period. And Cooper turns it over. Larry Bird said he wanted to hear more from the crowd in this game. I think he got his wish.
All right, America's game has truly become an international game of the 530 members of the media here. There are representatives from over 40 foreign countries, including Avi Bettelheim, who's a sports editor from the Ma'ariv newspaper in Israel. Is basketball that popular in Israel?
Yes, basketball is very popular in Israel. It's one of the two popular games in Israel. And we love NBA very much and know most of all the players here.
The players?
Like Magic Johnson and Kareem Abdul-Jabbar and Larry Bird. They are legends in Israel.
Well, all right, I understand that this game is being shown live back in Israel to some 400,000 viewers right now. Let's go back to Dick and Tommy.
Thank you very much, JB. And of course, the Russian national team will be coming to play the Milwaukee Bucks in preseason, as this sport really going international a big way in the NBA, right in the middle of it. True international sport, this basketball. Bird guarded by Cooper. Dennis Johnson has his shot blocked by James Worthy. And Cooper, it's a three-on-two break now. Thompson leaves it for Cooper. A three-point attempt hits. And there goes Michael Cooper, who set an NBA record in the championship with six of those baskets in game two.
This is also the best defensive unit that the Lakers can muster. Get up and attack.
They trap Johnson for the moment, and now a trap defense. First time in the series used by L.A. Bird misses. The rebound by A.C. Green.
What's happening with this defense right now? They're taking Boston out of their low post game.
Cooper going all the way. Worthy. Blocked from behind by Bird, and a foul by Scott. And a very timely, good foul by Byron Scott, because he saved the basket.
And Earl Strum was on the front end of that, and he wasn't going to call it because Danny Ainge was wide open. Here you're going to see the Celtics come in, and Larry Bird from behind. He loves to make that type of play. And the ball was up, and Strum right there didn't call it, but the other official did.
Four fouls on Scott now. 11-point lead for Boston with 1:40 to play in the third. Pick and roll. Parrish picked up by Thompson. Dennis Johnson. Parrish gets a big offensive rebound. That's a big basket the way the Lakers have been hustling lately.
They are really out attacking and pressing and trying to take the Celtics out of the inside game. They succeeded, but when Parrish comes up with offensive rebounds, no press will stop that.
And no, nothing will stop the Worthy play. And Tommy, I think we're going to be in store for a rousing final 12 minutes at least of this game.
The tail end of the season, the Celtics have given up much bigger leads than they have in fourth quarters.
Turnover, four on one break. Michael Thompson scores, and maybe time to point out, with the lead cut to nine, that Celtic bench has played only 13 minutes of this game. It's an amazingly low number for this kind of thing.
Well, Bird has always been a designated zone press with this outside shot like right here.
Misses, and the long rebound gives the Lakers a chance to run. Scott goes in, and he's fouled. And now they've got to separate the athletes again. Tell me, you get the feeling we're well into this championship final.
Well, their buddies got into it one game at a time. Boston came back here. The Lakers had their running game going. Now their minds and emotions are at full steam. They're at the boiling point. You're going to see the Celtics now come in and attack Byron Scott, and Bird just takes it again from behind, and he got hit in the face, and there you see the jostling between A.C. Green. Scott steps in and says, you can't do that to my teammate. And Kevin McHale, not, you know, wanting to be a little macho right now, but not get thrown out of the game, kind of talks to him and tries to keep the distance, and cooler heads prevail, as they say.
Personal foul is on Larry Bird, and a double technical foul against Byron Scott and Kevin McHale for their skirmish. No shots are taken on the double technical. McHale and Scott, double technical foul. No shots. But here is a big play for the Celtics a few moments ago.
Nobody gets to him, Mike, in that press defense. Very difficult to block somebody out. That leaves them a good position underneath to just pull it in and cram it. They don't have any real size. But Worthy right back with a sensational move with speed this time, and that leaping ability right over Kevin McHale's long arms.
Scott. McHale goes to the bench. So out there for the Celtics are Bird, Parrish, Darren Day, and Johnson and Ainge in the backcourt. So Day is the first sub in the second half used by Casey Jones.
And the reason being is that he's a better ball handler than Greg Kite. And with this press defense that the Lakers are throwing on, they need Darren Day's ball handling.
So the Lakers have cut a 16-point lead down to 7 with 13 on the shot clock in the third. Alert defense, and the basket goes very close, but the basket goes by Darren Day, who's the first man off the bench to score for the Celtics tonight.
That was a big hoop.
85-76, and a foul against Danny Ainge will be his third, and with 5 seconds to go, the Lakers will shoot a pair, and in comes their leader, Urban Magic Johnson, replacing Byron Scott.
Pat Riley doesn't like to leave Magic in the game to expend his energy on the press defense. He feels that Cooper and Scott are much better up front than Magic would be. Why tire him out with all that Cooper effort when you need him for the offense?
Scott goes out, by the way, with 4 fouls. Five seconds remaining in the third period. And a wild one it's been. Bird looking for help. Dennis Johnson at the buzzer misses. And that is the end of the third period with the score. The Celtics 85, the Lakers 78. And we'll return to Boston Garden for the final period after this word from your local station. Celtics in the Garden since the Lakers beat them in 1985. And Tommy, a lot of people thought the Lakers may have made the deal to win them the title when they acquired Michael Thompson from San Antonio right before the trading deadline, and he certainly paid dividends in this game.
Sure did. He came up and made a great offensive rebound over Greg Kite on a shot right here by James Worthy that they defended pretty well. Kite let him get good position, and he's an excellent offensive player. Then he came up the other end and made a defensive rebound to stop the Celtics' offensive dominance in that department.
Lakers have the edge in the important offensive rebound department. Michael Thompson has scored 12 points and has 7 boards.
Celtics trying to isolate Bird in a low post against the smaller Michael Cooper.
That's about the only time you may be able to take advantage of Cooper. 10 on the shot clock now. They find Bird loose inside. Loose ball. And on the line was Bird, turns it over to the Lakers, who can come within three now.
He was wide open.
Magic Johnson is holding his left knee, and Gary Beattie, the trainer, tending to him. We won't speculate, but Magic is in pain right now.
He's had chronic knee problems the last couple of years, and they always worry. Take a look on your right, and Bird is trying to hold on to the ball, and Magic comes right in, and they collide knee against knee, and Magic has had lots of problems with those knees, with the very same type of injury or happenstance, accidental bumping. And needless to say, he's the guy that fuels that fast break, dishes the ball out to the right people.
Isn't it amazing, as he tries to loosen it up, that the Celtics, with all of their ills and pain and all of that, and then Vinnie Johnson collides with Adrian Dantley, and the Pistons lose Dantley in the fourth quarter of the seventh game, and all the problems continue with the Celtics, how they're playing with all their big guys. Now Magic Johnson has a knee problem, and
gotta pay homage to the Leprechaun. I used to leave when I played here and coached a hot dog and a beer, and the next game when I come back, it was always gone.
It was a Leprechaun, huh?
It was the Leprechaun, I think.
Danny Ainge is in the ball game, and Worthy spins in, and it is now a three-point game at 89-86 as the Lakers going without Magic, and Scott back in playing with four fouls.
Celtics are not searching out the right matchup, and that press defense took them right out of their rhythm.
You called it right when they went with that fast lineup on both ends. Parrish misses. McHale, it counts. Tommy, Kevin McHale is at 10 of his last 11 shots, and he looks like the McHale of the healthy vintage regular season.
That was good attempt by Parrish, and here's McHale working against Magic, Michael Thompson.
Magic's back, and he's limping, but he's going to try to run it off. Scott goes out, and Michael Thompson picked up his third foul. Here's McHale with 25 points and 12 rebounds. He missed there, and the lead is five.
He moved off the free throw line before he really released the ball.
Celtics had a 16-point lead in the third period. And Seasting knocks it away, two-on-one break, and Magic breaks up that two-on-one advantage, and Riley is not a happy head coach right now, even though he's well-dressed.
Sometimes it pays to be only 6'2". Kareem cannot see him, doesn't even think he's going to bother him. And there he is, Seasting, taking it right out of his hands.
Tommy, Kareem is only one basket since the first period. 3 of 13 in the game. And they may need the big man before it's all over.
Here's Magic with the bad knee just hustling up and destroying what would have been a cram shot for Robert Parrish. So you can see that they've got as much gumption as the Celtics do, playing hurt.
Well, I know, Tommy, you have a lot of respect for both the coaches, Pat Riley and Casey Jones, and that's where they stand in the all-time list with Tred Auerbach leads. And it's probably no secret that these guys are so close. Now, Tred Auerbach with 99 playoff wins, and it was in 1972, a big Laker win with Pat Riley, who was a bench warmer, showered with champagne. And there's Casey Jones, who was a Laker assistant coach, congratulating Jerry West. But Riley and Jones cut from the same cloth in many respects.
Boy, and they bring a lot of history and knowledge of how to play playoff games and handle the pressure.
Ainge for the fake on Magic. His best game of the series by far, 19 for Danny Ainge.
That was an excellent shot by Danny Ainge. It was not a forced shot. It came within the flow of the offense.
The lead is 7.
Oh, no.
And Kareem is fouled. That is the first team foul against the Celtics here in the fourth period. The Lakers have also committed one. That one was on Bird. That's 2.
You better believe that Kareem Abdul-Jabbar is going to figure in a great deal of the offense coming down the stretch.
Dick Stockton and Tom Heinsohn in the wildest of the four games so far in the NBA Finals.
Lakers won the first two with ease. The Celtics won a tough one in game three, and this is tougher still. And the Lakers trying to avoid the Celtics coming back to even this best of seven at two apiece. Game five comes your way Thursday night at 9 Eastern, right here. Once again, a five-point game. Double on McHale. Ainge. Dennis Johnson with Worthy in his face. Good defensive rotation by L.A.
And they never let it get to Bird in the corner.
Three on three. Michael Thompson is fouled going in.
That is great pace basketball. They got the Celtics back, but they weren't in good position to stop a thrust to the basket, and Thompson just made a great play, didn't score the hoop, but drew the foul.
Four fouls now on Robert Parrish. He's the first Celtic to pick up four, but Michael Thompson doesn't take advantage of it yet. The hero of game three watching this one.
When your players get fatigued, the Celtics have faced in the fourth quarter a double-team offense against their low-post players, and the coaches of the other team say, beat us from the outside while your guards are tired. And that's proved to be a big strategy move by most coaches that have worked.
Are the Celtics getting tired?
They're missing some of those outside shots.
Parrish, and the clock runs down. So the Lakers, trailing by four, have a rejuvenated bench cheering them on, and Casey Jones calls timeout. So much time remaining in this one, and the Lakers creeping up.
Things the Lakers are doing are making the Celtics spend too much time just searching for a good shot. It goes into Parrish. Look at a triple team. And now, good rotation. Dennis Johnson turns down a shot that perhaps he should have taken. And again, they go around. Again, a double team. They try to force it inside, but somebody's there all over Parrish, forces him to take a poor shot. And the Lakers have got their feet moving on defense. Boston has really got to get the ball into the hands of Larry Bird and Kevin McHale. They are the guys that can carry him through this ball game, either get fouled or Bird, if he's double teamed, will find guys for better shots.
The Lakers were down by 16. They trail by four. Kareem fouled, and if that's Parrish, that's five on Robert. And it is.
Parrish has got him muscled out a great deal. I don't know why he went and bodied him. That's a tough shot, but he hit him from underneath with the top of his legs.
Now it'll be interesting, Tommy, as Greg Kite comes in for Parrish. He goes out with five after Kite's tremendous performance of nine rebounds and the spectacular block of magic. How the Lakers handle the physical Kite here?
Greg Kite is not as important to this ball club right now in the fourth quarter as he would have been in the first quarter. And I think the Lakers can take advantage of him and gamble off him. Kareem can go and get on the boards, and Kite is not an offensive option.
Lakers have scored five in a row. Bird has the shot knocked away by Cooper, and the Celtics have 12 seconds to try a shot. A 93-91 game, 6:36 to go, and apparently Casey Jones is going to go with the five great warriors to win this or lose this. Dennis Johnson misses. Kareem the rebound, and the Lakers can tie it.
And the Celtics are going into one-on-one basketball, just what the Lakers want.
Magic picked up by Bird. Michael Thompson is fouled. And they'll tie it up, perhaps, on the free throw line.
Lakers playing much smarter right now than the Celtics. Good defense by Cooper. Comes from out of nowhere, and as the ball goes over Bird's head, that's where a lot of people who with leaping ability like to block it after they tuck it behind their ear, so to speak.
The foul was on McHale, his fourth. Michael Thompson has 14 points. Magic with 27 leads the Lakers, and Worthy is second with 19. McHale has 25. And we've tied up. The Lakers caught up. Seven straight runoff by L.A. Kite sets a pick for Ainge, who unties it. And all of a sudden, the way the pace is gone, the score is now high. That's almost a Laker kind of game right now.
This is a half-court game against half-court game without Boston having Parrish run their big weapons in there.
Kareem hits the skyhook, and don't forget, he has been cold. So he's due to heat up, and Parrish is going to come back in the ballgame with five personals soon. Casey Jones not taking any chances. He wants to get his big man in there. Bird. A two-point shot by Bird. What a sizzler this is down the stretch. Isolate Worthy on McHale, who's got four fouls. Now Dennis Johnson helps. Cooper for three. And there's Dennis Johnson ahead. He'll be coming in a moment, the Chief.
What a play by Dennis Johnson. He knew that Cooper was right there zeroing in on that shot and had a chance to block it.
Air ball by Kareem, and here is Ainge. Magic is back.
Greg Kite does a great job of blocking Kareem Abdul-Jabbar off the hoop. Danny Ainge does too. It's 3-on-2 rebounding, and Kite kept it alive for Bird. And a beautiful outlet pass to Dennis Johnson, and Cooper got just angled out of the play in a great style. Now watch, just Danny Ainge just pick up that loose ball, very alert, and head up the court. And kind of a palming violation right there that he got away with. And Magic Johnson did not want to commit the foul and give him a three-point shot. But two big fast break baskets. The Celtics coming up with at the right time.
Ainge has hit his last four, so he really has come alive as those numbers showed. Six-point lead for the Celtics. They were up by 16, and the Lakers came back to tie the score. Ainge following Magic all over the place. Short. McHale the rebound. Winding down the 4 minutes remaining. The Celtics have scored six straight points.
Celtics have to get a basket here, really, to calm the Lakers down. Really make the Lakers anxious. But they've got to get a good shot.
Four on the shot clock, and Ainge with a long three-pointer. And McHale battles for the loose ball and a foul against L.A.
Correct. All mistakes. That was a very poor shot, but Ainge was under the gun, and here's Cooper just banging McHale for the rebound. Call for the foul.
And we have a new clock. Team foul. Boston 4, L.A. 2. Bird. Eight in a row by Boston after the score was tied at 95. And Kareem is fouled. Kite. And the Celtics are in the penalty now with 3:19 to go. Whoever thought we'd see numbers like those under a title fast break points.
The Celtics always keep their head up, even though they are a slow team. At any point in a ball game, if somebody's open, they are alert to that possibility, and it paid off with two beautiful baskets at key points.
Parrish comes in and Kite gets a hand going out. I think after game three, he'll always be a favorite now at Boston Garden. But Parrish is back in, and he's back in with five personal fouls.
And they may let Robert Parrish play Kareem one-on-one instead of doubling him, and he's got the size to maybe bother Kareem.
Kareem has only two baskets since the first period. Celtics looking to even the championship at two games apiece. And it's last touched by Bird. Let's see if they change the ruling. And they're going to call a jump ball because the two officials called it differently.
Now, the Lakers are perfectly capable, if the Celtics don't control this tip, of fast breaking. Here's the indecisiveness of this play. And did Worthy or Bird touch it? Nobody really saw it. Neither did I.
Well, if you didn't see it, no one saw it. That's a play on words. Loose ball, Cooper and Ainge and Magic. And guess what? We're going to jump it again.
Both teams digging it out here. Controlled by nobody. Danny Ainge had a shot at it. He really had it. Nobody had a hand on it. And maybe that was a little too quick a call as the Celtics came up with it, but it'll be jump ball nonetheless.
Celtics win. It's a new series. If the Lakers can come back, they're virtually in, knowing that they have two of the next three games on their home court in the Forum. So this is desperation time, perhaps for both clubs in many respects. Short on the left-handed hook. Kareem controls in a new clock for the Lakers. 103-96. Traveling.
Great help defense that time by Kevin McHale. He forced Kareem at the last instant to walk with the ball. Showed up at just the right time to confuse Kareem.
The Lakers have not scored in the last 3 minutes. Bird. Magic the rebound as we get close to 2 minutes to go, and LA will call a timeout. This score is a Boston kind of score, but the Lakers, with 7 points down, will plot their last strategy. The game was tied at 95 with 5:36 left, and since then the Lakers have not scored. Let's look at the important numbers here. Each team has an ample amount of timeouts remaining. The Lakers have two fouls to give, but they only have 9 seconds to do it, because once you get in within 2 minutes, you only have one foul to give. The Celtics are already in a penalty. It'll be Magic. It'll be Cooper, Michael Thompson, Worthy, and Kareem, and the Celtics with their starting five. And question is, can the Celtics hold on after going with their big guys practically the entire game?
The Lakers need a score, and not a three-point variety. They need somebody to get it going to the hoop and maybe get the three-pointer that way. They looked for the alley-oop. It didn't work.
Michael Thompson, they could have used the hoop. Larry Bird hit the deck hard. Thompson will go to the line.
There was a three-point potential there, Dick. Here's a little pick that they said Bird has to switch now, and then he has to go back and pick up Thompson. And Thompson could have gotten the basket and a foul as Bird goes down.
Michael Thompson is 3 of 5 from the line. All of these misses are big misses from here on in.
Celtics, needless to say, will try and work the clock down. But if they take it under 10 seconds, they still have to score a couple of more baskets. They've got to take good shots, not just waste time for the sake of wasting the clock.
Now the Lakers have only one foul to give. We're inside 2 minutes. Tightening up the defense, the Lakers with 9 on the shot clock for Boston. 5 now, and they almost tied up Parrish, and they lose it. Cooper. It's a three-on-three break. Cooper with a three and hits it with a minute and a half to go. It's 103-99, 103-100. And Cooper makes up half the deficit with one shot.
They are so capable, the Lakers.
And the Celtics throw it away.
They try to get it into McHale, and it was a poor pass by Larry Bird.
A steal, a Cooper three-point shot, now a turnover, and the Lakers can come within one. Ten on the clock. Worthy brings L.A. to within one with under a minute to go, and timeout, Boston. Going to the wire in by far the best game of this 87 NBA final. Let's carry the Celtics to 16 NBA titles. Dennis Johnson and Larry Bird from the field, but the Lakers have scored six in a row after the Celtics had scored six in a row to break a 95 all tie.
Well, Larry Bird will become very, very important. He can be a decoy on this play, give the ball to Bird, and see if he can spring somebody loose if he takes it to the middle.
L.A. still has a foul to give. Bird takes a long baseline shot, and now the Lakers with a chance to take the lead. Their last lead was 3.5 minutes into the game at 5-4, a long time ago. Kareem does it, and the Lakers jumping for joy, and they lead it 104-103, and another timeout called by Casey Jones. Now, Tommy, Kevin McHale is at 10 of his last 11 shots, but has not attempted one in the last 8 minutes.
That's the big mistake I think the Celtics made in the last 6 minutes. They have not gotten the ball inside, and they have settled for outside shots, and tough outside shots.
That's the game clock you see. The shot clock is 19, 5 second differential. Parrish playing with five fouls. Open his age. Bird goes for three. And the Lakers call time with 12 seconds left. Larry Bird with a big three-point bomb has given the Celtics the lead, and now it's the Lakers' turn.
Celtics trying to use a matchup of Robert Parrish. It didn't work in the double team. They rotated all the way around to Bird, and Michael Thompson not fast enough to bother Bird on the shot. But before that all happened, you watch James Worthy holding Larry Bird's jersey. You're not getting away from me. Could not get away from Worthy until Worthy had to rotate out. Look at the hand on the jersey. And finally, Worthy moves out, and Bird all alone in the corner, and it's 3 points.
And the reaction by the Celtic bench. The Celtics have one timeout, and the Lakers now have one, and the Lakers still have a foul to give, which could be important if they do miss a shot here. Now, Tommy, where do you go now if you're L.A.?
Magic or Worthy.
Kareem is fouled with 8 seconds to go. And, of course, with a foul to give and you're tied or ahead, it pays to get one then. These are important free throws for Kareem right now. He is 5 for 8. Looking to tie the game.
He's been there before.
Has he ever? Has he ever? And it's Lakers ball with 7 seconds to go.
That gives him a chance now to go ahead with a basket.
Riley wants to use his last timeout now. Games are decided by inches sometimes.
Celtics have great blockout position, and all of a sudden they can't hold on to it. Off McHale, out of bounds.
The Lakers have the ball and a chance to win it and go up 3-1. And if Boston can stop the Lakers, we'll be all tied 2-2. These are the hot shooters for the Lakers. Tommy, in the last few minutes, Kareem has missed two free throws and Michael Thompson one. Untimely free throws that could have changed the complexion of this one.
You're right there, Dick, but right now the Celtics are faced with a real problem. The versatility of the Lakers' half-court offense really has them guessing as to who might get the ball. Kareem is a great option. James Worthy or Magic Johnson in the low post being guarded by Dennis Johnson.
And Byron Scott is in the ball game now. 5 seconds to go. Magic with a hook shot. Scores with two. And the Celtics trail by one with 2 seconds to go. And the Celtics have used their last timeout. And Tommy, this is where the Lakers have a foul to give with 2 seconds to go. That if they use it, could limit the Celtics to 1 second left.
You're very right there, but a little good play forces McHale to have to switch out onto Magic Johnson, and he puts that quick dribble on McHale and gets into the defense, and there's that real junior skyhook working. Look at it again. Little stutter step confuses McHale. I mean, that's what a great ball handler and dribbler can do to a big man. And look at that outstretched hook shot just worked beautifully.
Magic said Boston guards a great shooting place, and he says one of the best in the league. He feels it was built for shooting, and he's proving it tonight by hitting 8. There you see the one foul to give. 12 for 20 from the field. One foul to give, and Tommy, and they got to make sure that they do it at the right time.
That is absolutely. And you know, one of the things, Dick, you can inbound the ball and you're going to shoot it quick with 2 seconds. And if they make that foul as the guy is launching the ball, that is a foolish foul then because it's shooting. So you got to be very careful even in the 2 seconds because the guy more than likely is going to catch and shoot. So it's the timing of that. If it was 3 seconds, maybe it's a different story.
In any event, we'll be with you Thursday night at 9 o'clock Eastern time for Game 5 here in Boston Garden. And the way the series is heating up, who knows? But the Lakers clinging to a one-point lead that would give them a commanding 3-1 lead in the finals.
Well, barring a miraculous shot right now, I think Pat Riley has done an absolutely fantastic job of getting the tempo back in the game that he wanted. The Celtics, I think, kind of gave it to them in the last 6 minutes.
Michael Thompson is back in to try to distract Dennis Johnson on the inbound. Bird fires it. And the Lakers have won, and Pat Riley and the Lakers dance off the court. This year's MVP, Magic Johnson, put in the winner with 2 seconds left. How fitting for the Lakers. Came from 16 back to win, and right now, let's go to James Brown. JB?
Magic Johnson, one of the best comebacks ever. Did you guys ever think that you were out of it?
Well, of course, you know, you get down because they're up 15, but that's the mark of this team all season. We've been coming back. We didn't get down on ourselves. We just had to get tougher on defense, and then we started finally hitting some shots on offense.
Did you think it was a conscious decision on their part to get more physical with you guys?
Well, you know, it was a conscious effort on our part, too. I thought that, though, we came out maybe over-aggressive. We were missing easy layups, easy shots, because we were so up. So we had to calm ourselves down, get back into our game. And we finally did that, finally in the latter part of the third on into the fourth quarter. But you got to give us credit. We played great defense, and we really boxed out.
You're in need, Magic. They're very tender. They have given you problems before. How does it feel now in preparation for Thursday night?
Well, it's still sore, but, you know, we came and hit me on the side of my knees, but it's all right.
Can you win it Thursday?
Well, we're going to go after it. We're sure going to try.
All right, Magic Johnson, the Lakers engineered one of the best comebacks in playoff history.